Peace, fam. Thanks for listening today. The first time that I appeared at Under the Radar was the first time anything happened at Under the Radar. I was the 10 a.m. performance at St. Anne's Warehouse on the first day of the first Under the Radar. I was performing a solo work that was organized as a series of letters from father to unborn son. That son is now a freshman at Howard University, and he voted for the first time this past November. So my art comments to you today come from a place of nostalgia, hope, Black Americanness, art bodiedness. My parents are immigrants from Haiti. My journey to America was seen through their eyes, and my personal journey is framed by watching them adapt to this country and to each other, to struggle as parents and to keep falling in love, or deciding to stay in love. Which brings me to Linda Ronstadt. I have three first memories. The first is an unfortunate incident with red fruit punch and my mom's all-white romper. The second is driving through the safari at Six Flags and a giraffe leaning into where I was sitting in the back seat of our yellow Pontiac to kiss my cheek. True story. And my third first memory is my parents slow dancing in the middle of our studio apartment in Rego Park to a Linda Ronstadt record. My parents have been married nearly 50 years, which I don't know how humans do that unless there's something like art that keeps you close and empathetic and human. How do we learn what love looks like? And what is the soundtrack for that love? I am broadcasting to you today from the end of 2020. And there's a lot of wreckage strewn about. And also the worst cultural hangover from a cocktail of stunning lack of vision and humanity emanating from the nation's highest office and the literal halting of our field's entire business model. I am in the demo of arts workers impacted by COVID-19. I have lost revenue, I've been furloughed, I've canceled premieres. This is the season of loss and adaptation. My entire livelihood is built on bringing people together, and I am personally struggling with a fear that it'll be years, not months, before I feel comfortable around people again. I am personally implicated in the stakes of what the culture sector does next. Also, Georgia went for Biden in November, and I'm obsessed with Stacey Abrams. When Ms. Abrams joined the state legislature in Georgia in 2010, Democrats controlled no statewide offices, and she put together a 21-page PowerPoint deck that was her diagnosis of the challenges facing Democrats and what they need to do to claw power back by 2020. She came with a 10-year plan for the vote. And I'm on some, what's the 10-year plan for the arts? So I guess that's where I begin and what colors I'd like to share. I have a deep respect for the founding principles of this festival and for you who have engaged it forever, or maybe today for the first time. I'm thinking a lot about love and how art sustains it. About half of the drama and the trauma of this critical moment in American public health is the collision of epidemiology and infrastructure. And the other half of this same moment is cultural upheaval. And my work in the arts has lived in the intersection of those phenomena.
All over the country, America is trying to reconcile the moral economy and the structural economy. In many cases, we're navigating backwards through our history, looking at the past through the filter of present repercussions. America says, how the fuck did I wake up here with this knee on my throat, with a president that won't denounce white supremacy, with little kids being driven by their moms across state lines with AR-15s to hunt Black folk who are mad that one of their own got cop shot in the back seven times? Racism is an American narcotic. In 2020, we wake up sick.
Let's say we get well.
What do we see when we envision the public's fullest health? Where is the artistic thinking in our leadership practices? Who is leading the public imagination? Who is articulating the contours of the American dream? Let's say we had 4 years to prep the country for a Black woman to lead it. Let's say that's the task we have till 2024. What is our cultural thesis? Who is the heartfelt center around which we might build a moral direction? How do we heal a deadly virus, an explosion on the racial timeline, and an abusive level of gracelessness at the highest levels of government? I am convinced that this country will eventually produce a national plan to test, protect, vaccinate, and sustain its citizens in the age of COVID-19. We will design an infrastructure to store vaccines at 100 degrees below zero and other systems in the name of public health. But what of public healing, which is different?
Somebody is designing the means of sustaining our bodies. Is there someone right now designing replicable means of recalibrating our psyches from the trauma of this year of fracture, uncertainty, and loss? Is there somebody right now drafting a Marshall Plan for national healing?
So, I want to spend the rest of my time with you sharing some ways that I've attacked that question as an artist, as a curator, as the guy in charge of social impact at the Kennedy Center, and as a citizen philosopher who deeply believes in cultural leadership.
OG, say, love yourself, baby. OG, say, self-love leads to sex love.
OG, say, time did not reconcile me to my chains. It made me familiar with them.
Say black and hear yes. Say black and hear enough.
In my artist body, I'm really enjoying an interface with classical forms. I'm working on a pocket opera for the Washington National Opera, composed by Carlos Simon, premiering in 2022, and a full-length opera, directed by Bill T. Jones and composed by Tamar Kali, premiering at the Perlman Center in New York in 2023. I'm making a short digital work in collaboration with the South African choreographer Gregory Makoma, with media design by David Slaza. That's been commissioned by the American Dance Festival and will be completed and premiered in February of 2021.
Pre-COVID, I was set to premiere a new community-based project in Oakland, working with Brett Cook, Destiny Arts Center, and the families of six Oakland natives, all who lost their lives or who had their lives taken from them before they turned 33. The piece is called The Black Hole. It was set to premiere as a proscenium piece in April of 2020, but we had to pivot to make it a documentary instead.
I share this to say that I feel the stretch of COVID across multiple aesthetic terrains. I feel myself stretched across multiple identities that range from my institutional perch, where I am restricted but generative and bold, to my curatorial and artistic practice, where I am inquisitive and more politically provocative, to my citizen self, where I feel morally obligated to consider how freedom is designed, where I want to think strategically about creative materials needed to build an equitable and inspired social vision.
And for the last 2 years, I've been the vice president and artistic director of social impact here at the Kennedy Center. I am of the privileged and the hunted. I work with the belief that if racism is structural, then anti-racism also must be structural. That's why we're announcing a system that we're committed to growing over the next 3 to 5 years. We're gonna be investing more than $1 million annually in the local creative economy. We're showcasing artists from all 50 states. We're gonna activate the reach with a lens on public health. We're connecting Black art to anti-racist organizing through our Black Culture Matters initiative. We're commissioning young composers of color in the classical music realm, focusing on cultural leadership and community action. We're working to produce symbols that inspire while cultivating systems that sustain an equitable future.
I work at the Kennedy Center, and I am seeing firsthand that when the earth quakes, the monuments shake too. Candidly, I'm really proud of the programs that have emanated from the Kennedy Center in 2020 that function in the spirit of the video that we just watched. I'm equally excited about the metrics and evaluations that we've developed to measure the efficacy of our programs. And I'm thirdly excited about the social impact strategic plan at the Kennedy Center, which commits to investing $25 million over 5 years so that 25% of our programming is impact facing by the year 2025. 25% impact facing by 2025. There's a whole story to how we got to that plan, the steps that it'll take to ratify the plan, and the steps that we'll take to execute it. In this case, though, in the context of these remarks, the specifics might be a little less useful than talking briefly about the ethical construct and the institutional stakes of not moving quickly and decisively in this direction. So I want to call us to two phrases to pull from that video. The first, if racism is structural, then anti-racism also has to be structural. If we believe in systemic racism, then our ambition is to be systemically anti-racist.
That phrase names our frame and our modality. The truth is, racism is the primary vehicle through which American capitalism was born. Racism is historically the vehicle for capitalism. So if you can't be anti-capitalist, you can't be anti-racist unless you're systemically invested in historically stigmatized communities. For instance, our Black Culture Matters initiative isn't just about putting Black bodies on stage. It's about putting Black organizations in residence and in conversation with those bodies and their audiences, organizations that specifically work in the realms of Black wealth, Black health, and Black relationship to law.
The second phrase, I am of the privileged and the hunted. That frame just names the stakes, the personal stakes of doing this work. When I think of most of the organizers I really love and have learned from, Brett Cook, Shanaka Hodge, Hadari Davis, Tongo Eisen-Martin, Deborah Cullinan, Theaster Gates, Rick Lowe, Karan Davis, they are artists making oasis for cultural health in soulful ways. Theirs are acts of intellect and community, and also the intense feeling that both their ancestors and the slave catchers is on their ass. And they are. Fight and flight. I ask of arts institutions and the people who support them, if not a pandemic, then what act of nature? Like the poet Nicole Seeley says, what hysterical strength do we need to lift the country up? To act as some of us must. With the courage it takes to survive with our collective health intact.
Now, with that being said, my political body doesn't quite fit inside of my institutional suit. So this past fall, I developed an online campaign called 45 Lies, with independent producer Kirsten Magwood, Camila Forbes of the Apollo Theater and HBO's Between the World and Me, and my man Anthony, one of the co-founders of Freestyle Love Supreme. 45 Lives was my creative outlet during election season and became a means of engaging and collaborating with artists of all stripes, from poet Jasmine Manns to author Jason Reynolds to Black Thought of the Roots to Kerry Washington to Naomi Campbell to Kyle Abraham.
I'm Stacey Ann.
Hi, I'm Zuri, and this is my dog Phoenix. And Donald Trump says that coronavirus isn't dangerous, but you see all so many family members, so many people dying right now. So that's why you should vote.
That's why you should vote. The coronavirus isn't dangerous. Like, businesses are closed. Like,
I can't see my family, my friends.
We can't travel anywhere. Like, people can't go to school. Oh, that's not dangerous. Don't be an idiot.
This is why you should vote.
That's why you should
vote for Biden. And kick Donald Trump out of business.
Kick him out of business. Kick him out of office. Shut him down. 45 seconds to say no to 45.
Bruh, remember when you put kids in cages on the borders of the land of the free? You did. Remember when you tried to spit the line that there were good sides of white supremacy? You did. Wasn't you the dude talking about the pandemic was a ruse? This would all be over soon? Let me see. You lied, benign, still on the rise. 200,000 died and ain't a fucking open sight. So yeah, fuck this rapist. His white family in his face that's treating government like it's their showtime. Shameless. Trips on private jets we know now are child slave ships. Draft dodging, tax dodging, pussy grabbing racist. Fuck you and anyone who claim you. It's basic. I guess I want to do you like you did immigration. Make you do a bid, jail your kids, lock you with the sick, begging for asylum, let you die on a waiting list. Cause I don't got time to remain this pissed. This fool praying we don't show up on the day for this. But I was raised in the Bay where we bout it. Better get you bout it, time to get it counted. Cause I hate this bitch. 45 lies. A lot more than that.
The premise of the work is that the 45th president lies so incessantly that we've become desensitized to his falsehoods. Hip hop culture contains the talent, the reach, and the credibility to battle these lies, especially in time to encourage action and dynamic response during election season. 45 Lies was organized as a viral campaign to hone and unleash our potential when democracy was literally on the line.
Lyricists from around the country each take 45 seconds to directly challenge one of 45's blatant and dangerous falsehoods. In self-filmed videos, each lyricist makes it clear why a particular lie is so dangerous, who it affects most, how the distorted truth connects to more systemic harm for historically stigmatized communities.
At the same time that each video was released on IG, we also launched 45lies2020.com, where anyone could watch all the aggregated videos in one place, and anyone could read a list of the egregious lies that our journalistic partners assembled. Besides the artistic release of 45 Lies, putting it all together became a really good case study for me of curation in the time of COVID. For starters, the engagement was bananas. We racked up 20,000 Instagram followers in the first couple of weeks, and the videos generated 8 million views across platforms throughout the campaign. But critically, this thing happened where I asked dancers who I would normally book for proscenium performance to hook up with lyricists that they'd otherwise never worked with, and they really wouldn't have the occasion to in the proscenium space. I'll show you three examples. The first is the choreographer Emma Portner moving to a piece performed by Hamilton's Jay Dixon. The second is Daveed Diggs spitting a piece that inspires Lil Buck. And the third is Kyle Abraham moving to my original audio.
What does it take to run a country, you ask me? Probably a little more than 750 in taxes. Trump and bending over backwards to hide the truth and lie to you. Even when we provide him proof, and I insist we get rid of this hypocrite, this belligerent poor excuse for a president living up in all residents. Oh yeah, that's right, we own the home that you in. So try to fight this here eviction, we gon' turn it to a prison. And listen, you all on TV talking about you spending millions in taxes when it's evidence you ain't spending jack shit. Turn a MAGA backwards again, great Americans make the decision to become what we envision. Your hair's a lie, your skin is a lie, your man's a lie, and that's that. I vote in the House, I vote in the Senate, I'm voting you out, and that's fact. So I hope you have your bags packed, cause whatever dusty orange hole you crawled out, we bout to send your ass back. Vote safe, vote early, and vote him out. 45 lies.
45 lies, let's get it. Look. Let's talk about his opportunity zones. The $100 billion lie this motherfucker proposed. Say, and he poured the money into the hood. But you know, the thing about money is we can track where it actually goes. At best, it's been invested in expensive student housing. But the rest of where he's spending it is even more astounding. When a man can claim he's spreading out the national wealth by pouring it in storage units and his high-rise hotels. The ones you own and stay in with your billionaire bros. Your pockets, ain't that where the money actually goes? Count stacks on our back, not mending a crack in the road. And using lies as distraction as he go and promote the murder of black on the blocks where the same poverty locks us in. And the fact is audacity as him asking for office again is an obvious mark of an intractable narcissist. And 45 seconds ain't even close to enough bars to spit. Fuck 45 lies, vote his ass out November 3rd. Yeah. Starters, this motherfucker lied about his inauguration size, which isn't as racially charged as Charlottesville, both sides. It's not the coronavirus, don't wear a mask. It did not cost 200,000 lives, really didn't cost a thing. Except 10 times as many folks showed up for the black guy, but that guy raised 100 mil and did relatively little for his inaugural, which him socking the dough away isn't even the point. The point was the totally useless lie, the abuse of an obvious objective truth. The fool was president for less than an hour, already blinding folks with his tiny fingered gaslight. Less than an hour already crying public enemy number one was our own fucking eyes. On day number one, 45's lies was the truth only a fool could believe. A lie to say, don't you dare believe what you can plainly see. Now look here, here lies democracy.
All of us in the field are in a new frontier of digital strategy execution. Our small team, Kirsten, Camila, Drina, Anthony, with additional support from Sozo Artists, we put together a successful campaign with literally no money. We had social capital, we had political urgency, and I think, and this is key, I think we had an interesting and timely prompt. An artist showed up. I'd love to take that formula back to my institution if I could, to be in political cahoots with artists and have that be the driving digital strategy. To forge unlikely collaborations via urgent political questions, institutions as the channels that enable artists to speak truth to power. In my artist body, I want to engage the political moment in both abstract and literal terms. Because we have to. Because in my artist body and as an arts professional, I know the only reason Trump could not pull off a coup is because he did not have a decent dramaturg.
From a playwright per the theater of a coup. It's theater in November. Someone's got to fall. The question is who? What's the plot? What's your main actor's character? Who's your audience? What are you asking them to believe? Like, have you trained your audience to suspend their disbelief so that when by the final act, the fact that your main character is a fraud and then gets applauded by half of the Greek chorus, you don't lose three quarters of your audience per the theater of a coup? Who's buying the tickets? Who's most critical to the success of the play, the audience or the critics? The rise of the fiction or reality's physics, felling the felon at the center of the action. Who is the foil that incites the fall? In the end, what do you leave your audience with? Is your plot foolproof?
In my citizen body, I want a federal Department of Inspiration. I believe
Inspiration is a right protected by the 14th Amendment. I want the NEA and the FDI. I want a 10-year cultural plan where at the end, there is a Secretary of Education, a Secretary of the Treasury, and a Secretary of Inspiration. Our country is in a rut and could use some resources to consider the infrastructure of inspiration.
Frankly, this is a great time to collectively build an ecology where cultural institutions adopt a new identity in our communities, where we can repurpose artistic intellect for the healing that this country will desperately need. My belief is that most performing arts organizations will struggle to restore their pre-COVID functionality or viability. We cannot realistically imagine that in 2021, our goal will be to sell every seat in our houses. Even as social distancing policies gradually relax, there will be a post-traumatic cloud of nervousness over our public gatherings. At least for a while, the proscenium cannot be the beating heart of our purpose. It will remain a significant organ in service of our expanded mandates. But smart arts organizations are presently crafting immediate 3-year strategies that anticipate a significantly lower appetite for extended proscenium experiences in crowded spaces. Arts institutions have to reconfigure how we think about space itself. My belief is that viable performing arts organizations must reconsider their post-COVID mandates so that they include social practice artistry, public health, fiscal health, brand expansion, digital production, and an embodied creative commons. I had an illuminating conversation with a mental health professional about the nature of race-based hate, which I initially characterized as a pathology. Pathology, as in there's got to be some kind of test a person can take before they're admitted to the police force that measures a dangerous level of racism. That officer, those men in Georgia, they're psychopaths, they're sociopaths. She patiently, clinically corrected me. She says, at a minimum, racism is not a psychological disorder because it can be taught. You cannot teach a psychopathy. So if the racist can be a healthy individual, it stands to reason that the society and the social codes therein are the underlying issue. Racism is a symptom of a sick society. A psychologist diagnoses an individual who then does the work to self-stabilize or heal. Similarly, an artist diagnoses society. An artist gives society the tools it needs to see itself, all the good and all the possibility, and also all the dis-ease from which it might heal. In a short period of time, we're gonna go from thinking about public health from a virological standpoint to thinking about health from an emotional standpoint, health from a post-traumatic standpoint. We have to frame post-pandemic infrastructural objectives, not just as a matter of public health, but as a proposition of public emotional and psychological healing. We must also apply systems thinking to that healing. And understanding that if we're going to stabilize our economy, we're going to have to make psychological ease and re-entry into the public square a function of our planning. That takes vision. And frankly, after years of being led by fear and dystopic pronouncements from a violent narcissist, leadership has to be co-held by truth tellers with a clear imagination of how we might all thrive, which means finally, if we are to systemically heal, we cannot marginalize the creatives among us who inspire us for a living. A national plan for healing must involve policy experts, working with public infrastructure veterans, collaborating with art producers, couched in the language, science, and higher calling of medical professionals.
on January 8th, I'm going to serve as co-host of a new podcast called Active Hope. The podcast is a joint venture of the Apollo Theater, National Sawdust, and the Kennedy Center. My co-hosts are Camila Forbes, the executive producer of the Apollo, and Paola Prestini, the co-founder and artistic director of National Sawdust.
The podcast is so named because that's where our creative conversations kept landing. Hope, all of us parents, all of us in our 40s, all of us within one generation of our families immigrating to the United States, all of us practicing artists, all of us leading really different arts institutions, all of us actively stuck on hope. I am in my artist body, a citizen. My job is social impact. I don't have time to not be hopeful. Holla at me if you feel the same. I look forward to doing the work with you. Peace.
I just wanna live. God protect me. I just wanna live. I just wanna live.